legacy would you like to leave behind? Or better yet, I think I may have asked this question. What would you want engraved on your tombstone? There's a man that we've probably talked about this before, but we're going to talk about it again, because there was a man who lived who did not taste death. His name was Enoch. And if you look in Hebrews chapter 11 and you look at verse 5, I don't even think we're going to read the whole verse, since everybody knows it. We're going to read the last part. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. Wouldn't that be a neat epitaph? Wouldn't that be something really neat to have engraved on your tombstone or on your marker? And for people to know it was true. You see all kinds of markings on tombstones. Great dad, great mother, loving wife, loving husband, grandchild. Not that. But wouldn't it be really neat if every Christian who passed through this life could have engraved on their marker they pleased God? There's not very much in our society today that I think would please God. In Syria, there was, you all know the United States is trying to decide whether they're going to go over there and hit Syria or not. But in Syria, just in Syria lately, the leaders of that country have been accused of gassing their own people. In World War II, Jews were handled like cattle, carried to concentration camps. Experiments were conducted on them. They too were gassed. We read each day and hear each day violence against other people. I just really don't see much in our society that pleases God. Even in our churches, people who are supposed to be born again, baptized believers in Jesus Christ may not come to church. They don't serve. Pretty much again do what they wanted to do. That question, is that pleasing God? Enoch was a man who pleased God every day. The Bible tells us that he didn't taste death, he didn't see death, but God took him. And before God took him, he left that testimony that he pleased God. Enoch was a man who towered above his generation. And he's still impressing people today, centuries from the time of his life. If you want to find out more about Enoch, you can look at his impressive biography. That biography can be found in the book of Genesis in chapter 5. It can also be found in chapter 11. Hebrews, and it can also be found in Jude chapters 14 and 15. Enoch didn't become great because of his scholarship, his statesmanship. He didn't become great because he had a big military reputation. He didn't become great because he was involved in all kinds of charitable work. He became great because he walked with God and pleased God. Of course, pleasing God is the highest praise that can be bestowed on any person. If someone says to you that I think that you have pleased God in your actions and in your life, you better cherish those words. So if for 300 years Enoch could walk with God in a sinful world, it shouldn't be impossible for us to walk with God today. You say, well, Enoch didn't have to experience the things that we experience. But I want to challenge you to think about something. The sins that we experience today were the sins that were experienced in Eden's time. The Bible says there is nothing new under the sun. The only problem is, in Enoch's time, you just didn't hear about it that much. There wasn't as many people. There wasn't the communications that we had. But sin was still rampant. And Enoch walked with God and pleased God. So here are some recommendations. You can take them or leave them. And some conditions for walking with God. The first condition is genuine reconciliation with God. There are a lot of people in our churches today, there are a lot of people in our world today, who claim to be followers of Christ, but who are sadly mistaken. They really don't have a spiritual, personal experience with our Lord and Savior Jesus. And genuine reconciliation with God assumes that you are walking with God in a personal faith in Him and His Son. Every day you walk with God. The second condition, is being completely yielded to God. Enoch knew that it was God's right to choose the path. We want to choose our paths, don't we? We like to choose our paths. We do it every day. If you have a GPS in your car, how many times have you not followed the path that that GPS takes? Turn right, turn left. Got a question for you. If you're not going to follow the directions that that GPS gives, why in the world did you buy it? Why in the world did you turn it on? Why in the world did you mount it in the car? Why in the world did you plug it up? Why in the world did you push that button if you weren't going to listen? Another example. Do you listen to what your doctor has to say? I don't. I don't listen to what he has to say. And if I don't listen to what he has to say and I have problems down the road, whose fault is it? It's mine, isn't it? If I'm going to pay him good money to go and visit him, I should listen to what he says. Enoch knew that God had the right to choose his path. He didn't go down a path that God didn't point him in. And the kicker is, sometimes we do things that we know are right, but we go down that path kicking and screaming. Anybody ever done that? Enoch, you read the account of Enoch, you'll come to understand, you'll come to believe that Enoch went cheerfully down the path that God laid out for him instead of his own way. Enoch also knew that it was a privilege, or it was the privilege of God to set the pace for their walk. You ever get ahead of yourself sometimes? You ever want to speed up the process a little bit? Sometimes we get in trouble when we speed up the process. If you are walking with God, if you are pleasing God, God is setting the pace. Sometimes we get a little antsy when the pace doesn't meet our conditions. But Enoch knew that God had the right. So Enoch never ran ahead or lagged behind. He kept pace with God. The next thing is supreme love for God. Enoch's love for God kept him from indulging in those sins and forced him to walk closely. How easy is it for us to just succumb to the world? Easy. It's very easy. We're programmed for sin. We're programmed to look at the things that the world has to offer, and they shine like a shiny dime laying on out in the middle of a parking lot, and you run over and pick it up. How easy it is to be lulled into a sense of security by the world. And when we're lulled into that sense of security, we begin to love the world more than we love God. I really do think that's our problem today, that we love the world more than we love God. And finally, you need to have an unbroken fellowship with God. You know what that means? That means walking with God daily. Not just when you think it's to your advantage. Most people will run to the arms of God, will pray in the name of Jesus when times are rough. Let sickness hit. Let financial difficulty hit. Let family problems hit. Guess what? Everybody is running to God. Take the case of 9/11. It's been quite a while ago, but we've forgotten pretty much about 9/11. But on 9/11, when those planes hit those towers, there was a big resurgence. People coming to God's house to pray and to worship. But after the shock factor wore off, they began to dwindle away. And now I think we're actually maybe statistically a little worse off now than we were prior to 9/11. Don't want to walk with God daily. We want to listen to what He says. We want to follow His commands. We want to study His word. We want to worship Him, but we want to do it on our terms. Not daily. When God's children walk with Him, God directs our steps, protects us from danger, and comforts us when we have sorrow. All this Labor Day. Tomorrow you'll go out and do who knows what. I don't know what you've got planned. Maybe a cookout. Maybe you're going swimming. Maybe you're going to do something else. But before you saddle up and do those things that you have planned tomorrow? Ask yourself these questions. Have I really genuinely reconciled with God? Am I completely yielded to God? Do I have a supreme love for God? And do I have an unbroken fellowship with God? If you can say yes to those things, you can probably be up there with me who walked with God and pleased God. All the things that we do, all the things that we say, all the services that we have, all the events that we have. Won't bring us any closer to God. But when we walk with Him daily, when we follow His leadership, and He is pleased with that service, we may not be elevated very high in this world, but we'll sure have a good testimony when we live this world. A good example for others to follow. Our testimony is presented every day we live. Do you please go? Father, thank you for your love and mercy. Thank you for watching over us, caring for us, and keeping your hand upon us when we tend to wander in all different directions. And I pray, dear God, that we might just take time to read over the life of Enoch and the other great leaders and worshipers of you that we have in your word. And somewhere we'll realize that it wasn't by accident that these people were singled out and were great followers of the faith in Jesus, love of you. Heavenly Father, give us the courage to be like they and stand each day in your service. Father, I pray tonight if there's someone here that needs to make a decision, now's the time that they'll listen to the Holy Spirit's call. I pray that they will respond with the courage that comes from knowing that Jesus Christ is Lord of all. Father, bless us now as we sing, for we ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. If God has spoken to you.